deadline in baseball is a week from tomorrow. The Tigers will be in Anaheim. Who comes back from that trip? It's a question or questions that we pose to the three favorite words of our female demographic. Continuing our theme here, those three favorite words are John Paul Morosi of MLB Network and MLB.com. All right, let's get into it. Matthew Boyd, I think, is perhaps the most intriguing name in the minds of lots of people in baseball. What are you hearing about Matthew Boyd?
Well, certainly, John, a scouting presence here tonight to watch him pitch, a very highly anticipated start for him to gauge where he's at. I think of all the starting pitching possibilities out there in the market, he is one of the most appealing. Maybe still some concerns with the home run rate of late. One team to mention here in a big way, the Brewers. They know that they need left-handed pitching. They know they need pitching for the future, and of course, Boyd, with the multiple years of control, a very coveted asset in that regard. The Yankees, I know there's been some talk there with the Tigers and Yankees on Boyd, too. The Yankees, to me, John, seem to be a bit more inclined, maybe on Mike Minor and Marcus Stroman for now, but certainly a lot of possibilities there for Matthew Boyd.
All right, as we continue the Ram breakdown, it's a discussion that you and I had just the other day. If you've got Matthew Boyd and you've got control of him for three more years, why isn't he a guy around whom you build?
It's an excellent question, and that's why, John, the price tag is very high. Because if on August 1st, he's still a Tiger, that's still a great outcome. And that means that they tested the waters and saw what was out there and decided that internally he was a better fit to be here. Now, if you can go out there and get two or three of an organization's best 15 prospects, you probably make a move, candidly, because then you have a chance to shore up more of your bullpen. You think about more of your rotation in the future. You think about the move, and it was different circumstances, but David Price in 2015. He was a rental back at that time, but with David Price, you were able to get back two members of your rotation in the future. That, at that time, was a very good trade.
All right, we're looking at Shane Green, who has had a career year, first half of the year. He found his way to the All-Star game. How much buzz is connected to Shane Green?
John, I think with Shane Green, and again, having some control beyond this year is a very key thing. I would expect the Dodgers, they had a scout over the weekend, a scout here tonight as well. They're very much involved in the Shane Green marketplace. I think the Braves, one more possibility. The Nationals, too. The thing with Green is he can close, he can set up. A lot of great possibilities there, too.
You're fascinated by the seating chart upstairs.
The seating chart is key. We had, on Friday night for Stroman, 9 different scouts there representing 8 teams, the Yankees with 2 scouts to see Stroman on Friday.
Okay. And the third name, of course, is Nicholas Castellanos. What's the likelihood that Castellanos will find a new home at the deadline?
Very strong. I believe by July 31st, 4 p.m. Eastern time, Nick Castellanos is going to be with a different organization. I look for him, the most likely possibility, Chris McCoskey's talked about this, the Chicago Cubs. They need a righty bat, and I believe, John, with a new team, we may see Nick playing more positions. I think that if he goes to the Cubs, they say, hey, can you play third base? Can you play left or right? I think he'd probably do that. And maybe even the team that's here tonight, the Philadelphia Phillies, they've been linked to Boyd, they've been linked to Green, and maybe even Castellanos as well.
All right, well, they can scout him directly as they play against him tonight and tomorrow afternoon. JP, thank you. So the